We're delighted to have here with us writer, philosopher, and very, very famous author, Colin Wilson. Colin, welcome.
Thank you.
How are you?
Yes, absolutely splendid, thank you.
I'm pleased to hear that. I believe you're very, very busy at the moment on yet another book. How many books have you written in your very long career so far?
Well, I couldn't have told you the answer to that until the bibliography of my work came the other day, a thing called Colin Wilson, The First 50 Years. And according to my bibliographer, I've done, 156.
That's a remarkable figure, and you're still working at the moment. Mm. Can we just go back, if we take you back to your earlier years, because you've got an autobiography, Dreaming to Some Purpose, which you wrote, and I wondered if you could kindly describe, just in general, your adolescent years, your home background, and the influences and interactions you had during that period of your life.
Hmm. Yes. Well, I was born in Leicester, which is a town in the Midlands in England, in 1931. My father was a boot and shoe worker in a factory who earned about £3 a week. And, of course, I was born just at the beginning of the sort of bad period of the 1930s, so my family didn't have much money, although Leicester was a lot better off than a lot of Midlands towns. I had a couple of brothers later. I was the eldest in the family. In fact, the eldest in the whole family, and all, you know, cousins and all the rest. And I was always a sort of fairly bright child. And then I went to school, like most people, I guess, at the age of five. And immediately got interested in all kinds of subjects like geometry and then later on science. And when I was very young, I was fascinated by astronomy and by pictures of, you know, the great nebula in Andromeda and things like that. And my great ambition was to be a scientist when I grew up. Then, when I was about 9 or 10, I kept hearing this name Einstein. And so I went to the local library and saw a book by Einstein called Relativity, the Special and General Theory, and got this out and found it completely baffling. Could hardly understand a word of it. But little by little, by reading other things on relativity, I mean things with titles like Relativity Made Easy and so on, I gradually got the hang of what Einstein was talking about and got quite fascinated by it. And so what I was really hoping to do was to become a kind of second Einstein when I grew up. Then, when I was 16, I had to leave school because, you know, my family didn't really have the money to send me to a university. And in those days, I left school in 1945 at the end of the war. It wasn't automatically assumed that you went to a university.
Those were very dark years, weren't they?
Yes.
Materialistically speaking, even from a survival and a prospective point of view. So what did you decide to do then?
Well, I left school, and then I was invited back to the school to take a job as a laboratory assistant. And this seemed a very good idea, because as a laboratory assistant, I could study in my spare time and probably get my inter BSc and then my BSc. So that seemed an excellent idea. The only problem was that I left school in July 1947. And then, during the months before I got the job as a lab assistant, I worked in a factory. Well, I hated it. I can't tell you how much I hated it. And, you know, having to be there, for example, at 8 o'clock every morning, not getting off till 6 o'clock in the evening with just an hour off for lunch.
Mm.
And suddenly, because, you know, my life had always been relatively free, even though my parents didn't have much money, I couldn't believe, you know, that life could suddenly become so constricted and narrow. And the result was that I began reading poetry. I'd always been quite interested in literature, but I found this a tremendous emotional relief when I was feeling utterly miserable and really sick of life. And mostly, of course, I read the kind of things that you do read in your teens. T.S. Eliot interested me terrifically, The Wasteland, but also the poems of Edgar Allan Poe and so on, Ernest Dowson, the other sort of poets of the 1890s that Yeats called the tragic generation. And so I found that actually poetry brought a sort of feeling of tremendous relief. The result was that when I went back to school, I think it was in October 1947, I realized that I totally lost interest in science. What I now wanted was to be a writer. Now, for the past 2 years, I'd been tremendously interested in the work of Bernard Shaw. This was because in England, we had a thing called the BBC Third Programme, which actually started in 1945, just after the end of the war, and which specialized in sort of putting on, you know, intellectual discussions and music and plays. And one night, I think it was the second night of the BBC Third Programme, I switched on the radio, and it was a play by Bernard Shaw called Man and Superman. And I'd switched it on at the beginning of the third act of Man and Superman, which is that enormously long act that takes place in hell, with a discussion between Don Juan and the devil, and so on. Anyway, I just sat there listening, absolutely fascinated, because it was the first time that I'd ever heard anyone asking the question which had bothered me all my teens, that is, why was I alive? What was I doing here? And what was I supposed to do now I was here? No one had ever asked the question before, and here was Shaw asking it. And so I was fascinated. I was also very interested, but a bit dubious about Shaw's answer that the purpose of life is to try to understand itself. Although later on I saw, you know, yes, of course, that's what it's all about. It's life's attempt to become conscious, more conscious. And so, by the time I left school, what I wanted to do, by the time I went back to school, I should say, as a lab assistant, what I wanted to do was to become a playwright, like Bernard Shaw. And so, I went to school as a lab assistant and did all my work as a lab assistant, but the truth was, I was no longer in the least bit interested in science.
Your heart wasn't in it anymore, really, was it?
Not at all. And, of course, I realized that I'd better stay on as a lab assistant, because at least that still gave me quite an amount of freedom, since I was still doing school hours and yet the long school holidays. And I didn't want to go back to a factory. But anyway, it was unavoidable, because at the end of the first year, when our exam results came through, it was quite obvious that I totally lost interest in science. And the headmaster said, well, look, if you sort of promise to pull your socks up and work hard, you can stay on in the job. And I said, no, there's no point in it, really. Honestly, I'm no longer interested in science. And so I left school. The next thing I did was to go along to the employment office in Leicester, the Youth Employment Agency. And they sent me along to the civil service, the office of the collector of taxes. And so I became a junior clerk in taxes.
In the world of the grey man, really. It must have been that for you.
Yes, it was indeed very, very grey. And I hated that even more than I'd hated working in the lab. But anyway, the thing was, at the time when I'd been working in the lab, I'd had a very interesting experience which has influenced me all my life. I'd getting into these conditions of tremendous boredom and irritation. One day, I was filling in my journal. I'd started filling in my journal, by the way, when I was 16, and I found that this was wonderful, the pouring out my frustrations onto paper really was very, very important. I taught myself to become a writer by keeping a journal. And one day, writing in my journal about how frustrated I was before I went off to my evening chemistry class, I suddenly thought, I know, I'll kill myself. It suddenly seemed to me that, you know, there was something absurd about life, that you made tremendous efforts, and then the efforts all came to nothing, and you were, you know, the next day you were feeling as miserable as ever. And so I decided that when I got to the lab in that evening, I would cross to the reagent shelves, take down the bottle of potassium cyanide and drink it. Well, I got there late as usual. They were all gathered around the desk of the teacher. He was talking about analytical chemistry. I walked over to the reagent shelves, took down the bottle of potassium cyanide, took out its glass stopper, but as I raised it to my mouth and smelt this bitter almond smell, I had a sudden extraordinary sensation. I became two people. One was this sort of little bloody idiot called Colin Wilson, who'd got himself into this state of misery and was going to kill himself, and the other one was me, the real me. And I realized that if this bloody idiot, whom I didn't care in the least about, killed himself, he'd kill me too. And as soon as I saw that, I corked up the bottle and put it back on the shelf, and was immediately filled with a tremendous sense of vitality and happiness and optimism, which lasted for several days.
This is yourself that you'd found, who'd maybe been pushed down all this time?
Well, I mean, all that I'd done, of course, was to realize that I most certainly did not want to die, and that I also saw that anybody who feels that they do want to die are simply in some way suffering from illusions. I'd always been a great fan of G.K. Chesterton, and Chesterton had said this a great many times in his work. There are certain moments, he said, when people experience what he called a flash of absurd good news, a kind of overwhelming feeling of absolute sheer delight in how marvelous the world is. And his reaction against the pessimism of the 1890s, people like Oscar Wilde and so on, was to invent a character in one of his novels called Man Alive, who goes around sort of putting a gun to the heads of these people and saying, well, you know, if you really want to die, I'll be happy to oblige. Which, of course, they'd scream and say, no, no, no. In other words, once you face reality, the reality of death, you suddenly realize that most of our worries are absolutely trivial and stupid.
That reminds one of, say, a condemned man. They say, you know, the mind is wonderfully concentrated when a condemned prisoner knows that he or she's going to die maybe in a week or something.
Oh, yeah,
is that
it was
right?
Dr. Johnson who said that when a man knows that he's going to die in a fortnight, it concentrates his mind wonderfully. And which, you know, is one of the truest things ever said. Has always struck me as one of the most basic truths of human existence. And so, in point of fact, I from then on realized that we contain an enormously powerful will to life. The problem is, so to speak, to get the trivialities out of the way. And then I saw that the basic problem of human beings is the fact that the trivialities of life, you know, particularly when you're young, the triviality of other people who don't particularly like you and make your life a misery, that the trivialities of life get completely between us and this reality we're talking of, this feeling of absurd good news. Now, I called it the bullfighter's cape, because it seemed to me that in a certain sense we're in exactly the same position as the bull, which keeps charging at the bullfighter, or rather charging at his cape waved in front of his nose. And whenever it hits the cape, of course, it goes straight through it, because the bullfighter is no longer behind it. And it seemed to me that this is basically true of human existence. Trivialities get between us and reality, and although we keep trying to brush aside the triviality, the bullfighter is clever enough to keep dropping the cape in front of our noses again and again and again. And I suddenly realized, with great clarity, that this is the trouble, what I called close-upness. It's as if you're standing in a picture gallery looking at a picture, but you're so short-sighted that you have to put your nose within an inch of the canvas. And of course, you don't really see very much of the picture. All you see is the texture of the paint. Now, what interested me were these moments that Thomas Hardy called moments of vision. He calls a volume of his poems Moments of Vision. These were what really interested me, moments of vision. What I wanted to know is, how can we keep achieving moments of vision when, for the most part, our lives are completely immersed in triviality? And you could say that, having said that, I've described to you what all my life's work has been about from that day until this, and that it's only little by little that I've actually solved the problem. It seems to me that what I've been doing all my life is fairly important, because nobody else has ever really tried to do it.
Now, at some time, you, in your early adult years, having come to this sort of this realization, you went abroad, didn't you? You decided to travel. Was that to get a feeling and to see that this wider picture that you describe?
Well, that is, in truth, the reason that I decided to go to wander around. But what actually happened was that when I was 18, I went into the RAF, because in those days everybody had to do their national service. And I found that I hated the RAF even more than I'd hated the civil service. And finally, I managed to get myself thrown out of the RAF by claiming to be homosexual, and which I'm not. Yeah. And but the question was, now I was back as a civilian after only a few months, and of course, the civil service didn't realize that I'd left the RAF. So for the time being, so to speak, I had a free space in which I could do what I liked. And my first feeling was, my God, I do not want to go back into a tax office and that utter boredom. And my father, of course, was shocked that I decided to give up being a tax officer, because he thought, oh, good, he's got a job for life. But so he threw me out of home.
Just
and
like
I decided that.
That
under the circumstances, I'd become a tramp. And that is, in fact, what I did from the age of about 18 and a half. I wandered off to Kent. This, fortunately, was midsummer, when it was possible to sleep under hedges and this kind of thing. I'd made myself a sleeping bag out of some old blankets. And I went around farms getting jobs apple picking, which is very easy to do in Kent during the summer. And I continued doing that until I'd made just about enough money to cross the Channel. Then I wandered all the way across France and landed up in Paris. There, by pure chance, I heard about a man called Raymond Duncan, who was the brother of the dancer Isadora Duncan.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
And Raymond Duncan ran a place in the Rue de Seine, which he called his academia. And he said that his aim was to teach people how to, as it were, do practical things. And he said, if you're a poet, then you'll be a far better poet if you can mend a tap. And this seemed to me an absolutely sensible thing. I'd always believed this. And so Raymond Duncan was persuaded to let me join his academia. And I stayed there for a few months. He was trying to teach me printing. But I must confess that, as usual, I'd got this sort of urge to move on, this compulsion, and this tendency to become bored with sort of ordinary jobs that it involved, you know, routine. And so I left him. I went along to Strasbourg, where I had a pen friend, spent a few weeks in Strasbourg, and then finally came back to England.
What do you think?
Next thing that happened was that I got myself a job in a big steelworks in Leicester. Got to know the nurse there pretty well, who was 9 years my senior, and ended by getting her pregnant, and we had to get married. So this seemed like an end to all my dreams of becoming a writer. Anyway, unfortunately, we were only married for 18 months because it was so difficult to find a place to live together in London in those days with a child. Landladies just did not want children. And after having 6 homes in 18 months, she finally went back to her home in Leicester and left me in London to try and find a new place. And as soon as we were separated, this terrific strain of changing home so frequently began to tell on both of us, and we decided we didn't want to get together again. So this is really why my marriage ended. And alone once more, I then decided that I would go back to France. that's what I did. So technically speaking, I suppose I really deserted her. I went back to Paris, and there in Paris, succeeded in getting a kind of a job working for a magazine called the Paris Review, which was run by a rich American called George Plimpton. I'm selling subscriptions. And there was another small magazine called Merlin, which was basically published by a man called Alexander Trokey, a Scot, who was a great friend of Samuel Beckett and who thought of himself as the next major writer. Now, I read Samuel Beckett's work. It just seemed to be no good whatsoever. And I must say, I've continued to feel this. Anyway, Samuel Beckett and the Merlin crowd were also people that I got to know. So, finally, I came back to England, and it was while I was in London, by this time I was 21, that I met my present wife. I'd gone to work in a big store, and the girl who taught us how to use the cash register on the first day I was there had the most delicious, good-tempered smile I've ever seen, and also had a very pleasant sort of voice. One thing I actually hated was the local accent in my hometown, Leicester, which is very guttural. And this girl didn't have this sort of nasty Leicester accent at all. She was about to get married and go off to Canada. She'd been at Trinity College in Dublin, and was about to marry a fellow student and go off to Canada. Anyway, I persuaded her instead to come to London with me. And that's what happened.
You rescued her.
Well, whether I rescued her, I don't know. But anyway, I convinced her that, you know, I had some important things to do. I was absolutely convinced that I was a genius. And, you know, it seems to me that anybody who has unusual talent is aware of it and would be a liar if he pretended he wasn't. And, you know, Shakespeare said, "Not marble nor the monuments of princes shall outlive my powerful rhyme." And so, in London, once again, I was forced to take all kinds of jobs which I loathed. I worked for a while in a kind of office of a place that sold cars. I worked in a wine company. And then, when I'd been in London for about 6 or 9 months, I suddenly thought, oh God, I'm absolutely fed up with this. I'm spending all my time working away like mad simply to make enough money to pay my rent. And that seems stupid, you know. If I was very lucky in those days, you could make sort of, you know, £3 or £4 a week. But of course, if your lodging cost you more than half of that and your food cost you the rest of it, then you certainly weren't going to have any opportunity to do very much else. Then I suddenly thought, but if I bought myself a sleeping bag and a tent and slept outdoors, I would save myself all that money.
It makes sense, yes.
I went along to a camping shop. I bought a tent and a sleeping bag. Actually, I quickly found that I didn't need the tent because it was an inconvenience. To begin with, it was too visible, so that if I was sleeping out in a field, let's say, north of London, then it was better simply to wrap myself up in my sleeping bag with a waterproof cover. And that actually is what I did. I went outdoors in mid-1953, and I stayed outdoors throughout the whole of that summer. And when I finally went back indoors in the winter, I once again got a job. It was an awful labouring job in a laundry. But I'd been writing in the meantime a novel called Ritual in the Dark, which was basically a novel about a serial killer like Jack the Ripper. I'd been writing this ever since I was a teenager. And in the British Museum reading room, which I went to every day, I'd met a writer called Angus Wilson, who worked behind the counter of the British Museum reading room. Terribly nice man. And when he saw that I was writing a novel, he said, "Oh, well, let me see some of it, and if I like it, I'll recommend it to my publisher." So I settled down to typing what I'd written of my novel. And just before Christmas in 1954, I handed over this novel to Angus. Christmas 1953. And handed over this novel to Angus. And then I had nothing to write over Christmas. So there alone in my room, I'd taken a room in a place called New Cross. Joy had gone home for Christmas to see her parents, but I didn't have enough money for the rail fares back to Leicester.
Oh.
And I started sketching out a book in my diary, which was going to be called The Outsider in Literature.
The Outsider in Literature. That was your intended title for it. Okay.
So I decided that I'd do this book, and that it would be about a series of people who just basically feel misfits in modern society, and who felt exactly as I did when I'd been a teenager, that, you know, they didn't like what modern society had to offer them. In other words, working away for 48 hours a week merely in order to keep yourself alive. It all seemed to me a sort of dreadful treadmill. Well, I decided that I would start this book in the British Museum early in the new year. And so, in the new year of 1955, I cycled down to the British Museum as soon as they reopened, and on the way there, I suddenly got an idea. I remembered that in the introduction to a book by a French novelist called Henri Barbusse, a book called L'Enfer, Hell, there had been a mention of a book that Barbusse had written when he was young and which had made him famous. This, in fact, was about a man, this was this book, L'Enfer, in which a man who lives in a lodging house finds a small hole high up in the wall of his bedroom. And by standing on his bed and peering through it, he can see everything that happens in the next room. And he becomes fascinated by the lives of the people who come and go in the next room, which is a sort of, nightly room where people change all the time. And he spends the whole book looking through this hole in the wall. I thought, my God, what a symbol of the outsider, a man peering through a hole in his bedroom wall. And so, as soon as I got to the British Museum, I asked them if I could have this book, L'Enfer, which had been translated as, I think, Inferno. And I spent the whole day reading it from beginning to end. Then, at the end of that day, I copied out a paragraph from it. And that is still the paragraph that opens The Outsider.
Yes.
A man saying, in the air on top of the tram, a girl is sitting, and a slight breeze raises her dress. And then he says, it is not a woman I want, it is all women. And I seek them in those around me, one by one. Now, that sort of desire for sex struck me as one of the most basic problems of, you know, the so-called outsider. That in a modern society, almost everyone suffers from a kind of perpetual sexual hunger, so to speak. Certainly all males do, to such an extent that an American judge judging a rape case remarked, the sexual impulse has a strength which is out of all proportion to any reasonable purpose that it serves. So, in stating that on the first page of The Outsider, as well as my thesis of the man who looks through a hole in the wall at the people coming and going in the next room, I'd stated some of my basic preoccupations. Anyway, while I'd been in Paris, I'd come across the work of the so-called existentialists, people like Sartre and Camus and so on. And I was fairly familiar with their work, and so I went on in that first chapter of The Outsider, after talking about Barbusse's L'Enfer, to talk about Camus' first novel, La Nausée, Nausea. And then a little later on, I went on to talk about, Sartre's Nausea, and then I went on to talk about Camus' book, The Outsider, L'Étranger. It's translated into English as The Outsider, although, of course, its title actually means The Stranger. So, I began to write, and I suddenly found that I was writing at a great speed and really enjoying it. I'd been preparing for this for years and years. I'd always been an absolutely avid non-stop reader, and of course I'd also kept journals. And so I just got everything ready. And not only was I fascinated by this whole question of the outsider, but I was also fascinated by religion. It struck me that most of the saints and great religious ascetics are basically outsiders. They're people who feel that, you know, they don't feel at all at home in this world, that they feel that somehow there's something wrong with human existence. Of course, the Catholics call it original sin. But it seemed to me that although, you know, that in a way is a good description, it doesn't really describe what is wrong precisely.
Could you term it, instead of original sin, term it instead as original thought?
Thought?
Hmm.
Not really, no.
No?
You see, it was something... what I was saying, in a sense, is that there's something slightly wrong with human beings. And what is slightly wrong is perfectly simple. Schopenhauer had already said it, that we want something badly, and that we feel that, you know, and we're absolutely certain that we want it, and then almost as soon as we've got it, we get bored with it. I'd noticed that as a child at Christmas. You'd so look forward to Christmas and your Christmas toys, and yet before the end of Christmas Day, you were taking them for granted. It seemed to me, you see, that human beings have something very slightly wrong with their mechanism. It's like a clock whose hands are loose so that it never shows the correct time. There's nothing wrong with a clock. It's just got loose hands. And this means that you can never really rely upon it to tell the time. And it seemed to me that human beings in the same way have something wrong with their minds. This something wrong is due to close-upness. It's due to the fact that we see life so close up that we never get an overall sense of meaning. It would be wonderful if we could suddenly, as it were, get a bird's-eye view of life from miles above it, in the way, of course, that people do when they're facing some horrible crisis. Sartre had once said that he'd never felt so free as when he was in the French Resistance and was likely to be arrested and shot at any moment. And, of course, he was really saying the same as Dr. Johnson about a man who's about to be hanged in a fortnight, it gives him a wonderful sense of concentration. Now, it suddenly seemed to me that that is the real basic problem of our civilization. We've spent so long fighting our way up from the animal until now we've got a fairly comfortable society, a very complex society, and the trouble is that it bores most of us stiff. And, of course, I was terribly aware of this from my own teens, from the fact that during the long school holidays, when I was a lab assistant, instead of sort of being delighted that I was free, I'd quickly get bored and think, oh, God, you know, well, what shall I do now?
Mm.
Clearly, it's some deep sense of direction that human beings lack. And if only we could deepen our sense of purpose in some way, then this problem would vanish.
Do you think that... part of this frustration is due to our not being able to keep in touch with our inner self? In other words, the robot functions all the time and maybe takes over more rather than less of our awareness and our day-to-day existence. And there's the true self buried right down inside that isn't allowed to emerge all the time. Now, that's a generalization, Colin, although... would you also say it's true that there are certain people who one calls well-adjusted and they're lucky-go-happy or happy-go-lucky, and they seem to be quite happy all the time? I believe scientists have actually done researches on why are there certain people, instead of being depressed or dysfunctional or emotionally disturbed, why are there other people who don't suffer from that at all?
Well, the answer, I think, is basically that the so-called outsiders are the people who have such a strong evolutionary impulse that they're perpetually pawing the ground with impatience. And their problem is this feverish impatience. But you've also put your finger on it when you mentioned my term, the robot. It struck me fairly early that that is the real problem with human beings, that we have inside as a kind of robot which does things for us. So, for example, you learn to ride a bicycle or you learn to talk French, or to do a lot of other things, and you begin by doing it painfully and slowly and consciously, and then the robot takes over and does it far more quickly and efficiently than you could. For example, you learn to drive a car, and soon it's your feet and your hands that are driving the car, and you can sit there and do very little. In fact, you might, if you drive home from work feeling rather tired, you might get home not even remembering the drive. The robot has driven it for you. Now, the thing is, the robot's terribly valuable, but he not only does all the things we want him to do, like talking French and driving the car, but he also does all the things we don't want him to do. For example, if you go for a country walk that strikes you as really marvellous, you think, God, you know, I'll never forget this, and yet by the third or fourth time you go for the same walk, it's the robot walking as well as you, and suddenly you're feeling oddly bored and tired. It's this thing, as I say, that Schopenhauer noticed. We want something badly and then no longer want it, and that's due to the robot. Now, the problem with the robot is obviously that we need him. We can't do without him. Although, in fact, of course, there are certain drugs that put him completely out of action. Aldous Huxley discovered that so-called psychedelic drugs like mescaline put a large part of the robot out of action and enable you to see the world with far more reality than you normally see it. You see, the robot acts as a kind of filter between us and the real world. And so it became quite clear to me that what we need is the mental equivalent of continual crisis to keep us on our toes. And that is somehow immensely difficult to understand. When I was on the point of suicide, I could suddenly see it with great clarity. I did not want to die. But then in no time at all, the robot once again takes over. And instead of this wonderful bird's eye view, you're back to the worm's eye view of ordinary human existence, and back to the bullfighter's cape. Now, of course, when I started saying all this in The Outsider, and this was the first time it had really been said in a certain sense, no one else had put all these things together in the same way that I did, and when I look back on it, I realize how lucky I was. Everything just fell into place. And even the acceptance of the book just fell into place. When I was on my way with Joy once to Canterbury Cathedral, we stopped at a bookshop on the way, and we saw a book by a publisher called Victor Gollancz, which was about mysticism and religion.
Yes.
And I said to Joy, you know, Gollancz would understand what I'm talking about. And so when I got back home, I sent Gollancz the first two chapters of The Outsider and an account of the rest of the book. And to my absolute delight, within 10 days, I got a letter back from him saying, this sounds extremely interesting. I'd love to see the book when it's finished. So, of course, I was turning somersaults of delight. I couldn't believe that I got a positive reply from a publisher. But the trouble was, I was sure that when he saw the whole book, he'd change his mind. So I worked on and on and on. And then, unfortunately, my mother fell ill with peritonitis. Her appendix exploded. I had to go to Leicester to see her. And I took the book, as far as I'd written it, into the office of Victor Gollancz. And I asked the secretary there if I could leave it there. And she said, no, I'm afraid Mr. Gollancz won't read unfinished books. And I said, look, please, I've got to catch a train in half an hour. I can't take the book with me to Leicester. Let me just leave it here. So she said, okay. Well, I got back to London about 3 weeks later, and my mother, fortunately, was beginning to recover, and found a letter from Gollancz saying, okay, we'll definitely publish this.
You must have been over the moon.
Yes, absolutely. Now, of course, there was still that fear that when I did the whole book, he wouldn't like it. But I went on to finish it. And really, the book had an enormous sweep because it went from existentialists like Sartre and Camus to saints and mystics. And also, there was quite a lot about Gurdjieff, who's always struck me as one of the greatest men of the 20th century. And also, of course, you know, the great mystics like St. John of the Cross and so on. This obviously appealed to Gollancz very much. And what I said in the last sentence of the book was that an outsider begins this long journey as a person who feels an outsider, but he may end it as a saint. I can see that this is the aim. The saint's control over consciousness. the ability, as it were, to sit cross-legged. Now, you see, in my mid-teens, I'd made a very important discovery. In T.S. Eliot, in the essays, I'd come across a reference to the Bhagavad Gita. Then, when I saw a translation of the Bhagavad Gita in a bookshop, translation by Christopher Isherwood, I bought it, and then realized that, in fact, if I sat cross-legged, concentrating very hard, for half an hour in the mornings before I went to school or work in the laboratory, it gave me a marvelous sense of freedom. And it was this concentration that really gave me the answer. I saw that provided we sit cross-legged and concentrate hard, we can push ourselves up to a degree of vitality where the robot no longer has the same power over us. The power comes from habit. And I could then see something very clearly, and that is this. Normally, in our ordinary state of consciousness, you and I are roughly 50% robot and 50% what you might call real you. Now, in those moments that G.K. Chesterton calls absurd good news, suddenly the percentage changes. You become something much more like 60% real you and only 40% robot.
A peak state of being, some people call it.
Yes, absolutely. A far more intense state of being. I'd also been always fascinated by Proust's novel, Remembrance of Things Past. How when Proust tasted that biscuit dipped in herb tea, he was suddenly overwhelmed by a strange feeling which he expressed by saying, I had ceased to feel mediocre, accidental, mortal. Suddenly this wonderful feeling of sheer happiness came over him. And it seemed to me that what had happened was that somehow Proust had sidestepped the robot. Now, what he realized when he was in that intense state was that it was due to the fact that when he was a child, living in a little village called Combray, his Aunt Leonie used to give him a taste of her biscuit dipped in herb tea. And what had happened was simply that tasting this biscuit dipped in herb tea when he was an adult had brought back with tremendous vitality and reality that sensation of being a child. Now, what had happened was that Proust, in other words, could normally say, oh yes, you know, when I was a child I lived in a place called Combray, but he wouldn't have meant it. G.K. Chesterton once said, we say thank you for the salt, but we don't mean it. We say the earth is round, but we don't mean it, even though it's true. Now, when Proust had tasted that biscuit dipped in tea, he could say, I was a child in Combray and mean it. Suddenly, it was a reality to him. Now, those moments when suddenly something which is an abstraction to you becomes a reality, I called Faculty X. And that seemed to me one of my most important discoveries, that there are certain moods and states of mind in which we become clearly aware of the reality of other times and other places. I'll give you an example. Arnold Toynbee, the author of A Study of History, tells how in 1912 he'd been climbing up Mount Taygetus in Greece, the mount that looks over the plain of Sparta, in order to get to the place called Mystra, which is a kind of little town halfway up Mount Taygetus, which had been a ruin for the past 100 years. Ever since the Turks burst into it in that war, you know, in which Lord Byron took part, and destroyed the town. Now, Toynbee said that he was sitting there, looking down on the plain of Sparta, chewing a bar of Greek chocolate, and in a state of relaxation, when, looking at a gap in the wall, he suddenly realized that that gap was the gap that the Turks had poured through more than 100 years before and completely destroyed this town. And suddenly it was a reality. It was as if he could actually see the Turks pouring through that gap. Time had disappeared. It was no longer 1912, but 1812. And that sudden realization that time could disappear completely because the reality was still as real as ever, so to speak, this I called Faculty X. Now, Toynbee, in The Study of History, in the 10th volume, describes 10 occasions in which the same thing happened to him. Again and again, he'd be in some historical place, and quite suddenly he would be overwhelmed by a deep feeling of the reality that this had really happened here.
So he'd been able to, somehow the veil of history had been drawn back, and he was at that time in place in an instant, suddenly, but at once.
That's right. And on one occasion, he says, on the 10th occasion, it wasn't just some particular event in history. He said, walking past the wall of Waterloo Station, quite suddenly he became aware for a few brief seconds of the whole of history. He said he saw history as a sort of giant river, and he saw his own life as a tiny little ripple on this river, but quite suddenly he was aware of the whole of history. In other words, the ultimate of Faculty X. Now, I saw that this is what we were really aiming at. This is what human beings are after, Faculty X. We want to generate this peculiar power of mind to concentrate very hard and to actually be capable of being in other times and other places. Now, it has struck me as a child that at Christmas, for example, when you're sitting in front of a nice warm fire and you're listening to snow pattering on the windows, you get this wonderful warm and happy feeling, and that feeling is due to the fact that you're in two places at once. You were there in the warm sitting room in front of a fire, but at the same time, the snow pattering on the window means that you are suddenly clearly aware that outside there, there's wind and cold and snow.
Well, this reminds me what you just said about the snow. You know the poet Louis McNeice, the Irish poet?
I knew Louis well.
Did you really? His poem, Snow, almost encapsulates that experience in many, many ways, where the room was suddenly still, he says, and the fire crackled. And he called it snow.
Well, that's certainly what I'm talking about, what I call duo consciousness, because suddenly your consciousness is not narrow, you're not in mono consciousness as we are most of the time, you're in duo consciousness, and as soon as you're in duo consciousness, you experience this wonderful sense of freedom and meaning. Now, it became quite apparent to me, The Outsider, I should add, came out in May 1956 and became an instant bestseller. I literally woke up one morning and found myself famous. Joy and I got up, went down to the corner where they sold newspapers, bought the two expensive Sunday papers, The Observer and The Sunday Times, and found rave reviews in both of them.
You were there. You'd suddenly become, overnight, you'd appeared from nowhere, and there you were. What was that feeling?
It was a really weird experience.
Really?
And of course, at first it seemed absolutely wonderful. I thought, my God, you know, no more factories for me. But, of course, what I hadn't realized is that becoming famous also has a very unpleasant side. It's like being put in a tumble dryer. You're whirled around, and so many things are happening, and it's all happening at a terrific speed. That was, by the way, when I got to know Louis McNeice. Louis worked for the BBC, and of course I did a lot of broadcasting and all that kind of thing. And suddenly there I was appearing on television, being asked along to sort of, you know, expensive dinners with dons and other writers and that kind of thing. So, but I found that it was all sort of rather too much for me.
Mm.
You see, I'd spent all my life as an outsider.
Yeah.
I just got used to working on my own and plodding on and not really caring what other people thought ever since my mid-teens, when the things I used to send off to magazines and so on always came back. I found that I felt so upset by that I just stopped caring and stopped sending them. And so this experience of suddenly becoming famous was vertiginous, and I hated it.
You were suddenly the upsider instead of the outsider, so to speak.
Yes, absolutely.
One could say.
I was the upside downer.
Yes.
Because the experience, and the worst of it was that also this tremendous fame caused also tremendous jealousy. And suddenly I found that I was living in an atmosphere of jealousy and attacks and viciousness, which in a sense has never gone away. I mean, only last weekend in the Manchester Guardian, there was a really vicious article about me.
Oh, it's endemic, unfortunately, and is unavoidable mantle that comes with such success. It is jealousy, as you say. That is a vicious trait of our humanity, I think. Jealousy, Colin. Could I move this discussion on to another passion of yours, which has long been a deep interest in the workings and causes of the criminal mind. You've written many books about this. Is it your opinion or conclusion that a criminal mind is either inherited or caused by some kind of mental disease, or simply affected by emotional scarring during the dawn of a person's life? Or is it, in fact, impossible to categorize or buttonhole such individuals?
Oh, no, not really. You see, what has always interested me about crime was the recognition that came to me when I was writing that first novel of mine, Ritual in the Dark, based upon the crimes of Jack the Ripper. The fact there is no nice, hard and fast line between the ordinary person and the criminal. It tends to, one blurs into the other. And it was this recognition that made me so fascinated by the whole question of criminality. Now, when I was a child, I got very interested in the murders of Jack the Ripper because my grandfather had lived in Whitechapel at the time of the Ripper murders, which was 1888. And his mother had said to him, "You've got to be back before dark or Jack the Ripper will get you." So, of course, this fascinated me. And I set out to learn all I could about Jack the Ripper. This was while I was still a child. And became quite an accomplished ripperologist, incidentally, a word I invented later. And this is what started my interest in crime, in a way. But then, you see, there was also this feeling that, basically, unfortunately, human beings, because they're so violently emotional, are always on the edge, so to speak, of crime. I mean, as I sit looking at the headline of today's newspaper, I see that a man jumped off a balcony in Crete, holding his little daughter in his arms, and after throwing his son off because his wife was about to leave him. People, and that, you would agree, is a criminal act.
Well, that's what the French call a crime of passion.
Oh, yes, indeed.
Which we don't distinguish that here in Britain.
Well, we do to some extent. But in point of fact, criminality has always interested me for that reason, that there is such a thin dividing line between the normal and the abnormal. Now, when The Outsider came out, it so happened that only 2 weeks before, a play called Look Back in Anger by John Osborne had gone on at the Royal Court Theatre. And Osborne again became famous overnight, and they quickly labelled myself and Osborne angry young men.
That's where the phrase came from.
It's where the phrase came from. And for the next 6 months or so, the press, having nothing else to do, just printed silly stories about angry young men. It was summer, and of course during the summer it's the silly season anyway. There tends not to be much news for some reason. And that was one reason that this sort of intense dislike of the angry young men built up. The feeling we were getting far, far too much publicity.
And way above your station, so to speak.
Yes, and also, of course, since the war, there hadn't been any new writers. Whereas after the First World War, there'd been a whole generation of new writers, like, you know, T.S. Eliot and Ernest Hemingway and Ezra Pound and so on, and James Joyce.
Sure.
Nothing had happened after the last war. And then suddenly, myself and Osborne arrived, as it were, at the same time. And everyone was shouting, "Ah, the new generation has arrived," and hailing us both as representatives of the new generation. Now, there was one basic difference between myself and Osborne. Osborne was just an emotionalist who was writing out of a sense of anger with his first wife, who'd walked out on him with somebody else. And the play was really an act of revenge on his first wife. So I went to see Look Back in Anger, and I hated it. You know, to begin with, I got Joy sitting at the side of me, and to see this chap on stage being so unpleasant to his wife seemed to me, I expected the audience to start shouting angrily at the stage. I mean, in England, we wouldn't put up with a play in which a man kicks his dog every few moments, Why should we put up with a play in which a man kicks his wife every few moments?
But wasn't that the point of the play, to provoke that reaction in the audience, do you think?
Well, no. Osborne was so wrapped up in his self-pity that, as far as he was concerned, he was saying something of great social significance. His wife's family, who were sort of typical middle class and all the rest of it, were the kind of people who ran England. And he called her brother, Nigel, the platitude from outer space.
And of course, the
critics thought that this was tremendous, that at least we were getting some real social criticism.
Mm-hmm.
And above all, a critic called Kenneth Tynan, who had become sort of better known over the past year by writing these reviews in which he said the English theatre is dead, suddenly decided, Look Back in Anger, by the way, was a flop when it first went on.
Mm.
And the first reviews the next morning said, you know, Mr. Osborne's just silly. It's just one long scream of self-pity. Then on Sunday, out came this review by Kenneth Tynan saying, this is a masterpiece. This is the kind of play we've been waiting for so long. And immediately, audiences began to flock to the theatre, and as I say, Osborne suddenly found that he was famous, not just in England, but in America, and eventually all over the world. And I found myself famous at the same time. And so suddenly you've got this notion of angry young men, but the angry young men were sharply divided. An enormous number of the angry young men, like John Brain and Kenneth Tynan, were basically emotionalists, whereas I, on the contrary, was trying to work out an intellectual answer to this basic problem of human existence.
You were more of a rationalist.
Absolutely. Osborne once said, I don't want to make people think, I want to make them feel. And I replied, they already feel too much. That's what produces so much criminality.
Sure, you were saying use your head as well as your heart.
Yes, absolutely.
In a sense. Let's go back to, obviously there was criminality briefly. You had someone like Jack the Ripper, whoever that was, and that's the jury's still out on that and may always be so, but you get a modern day, aside from what the French call a crime of passion, you have the calculated criminal genius who may lead a gang of people to rob, say, the great train robbery or rob a bank, those sort of crimes, and they are professional criminals who are callous, calculating, intelligent, ruthless. And then you have the psychopath like Jack the Ripper. Do you distinguish between the two? Both lack a conscience. How have they arrived at that state of mind?
In a sense, I distinguish between the two, but I also point out that, of course, there's a basic similarity between the two, and that is, crime is a miscalculation. There are very few criminals in world history who've actually succeeded in becoming what you might call highly successful criminals and remaining so. I mean, Al Capone was a highly successful criminal, but within 10 years, he was dying of syphilis and in prison. And I've noticed that again and again and again this tends to happen. Now, I have a feeling, and this is where you may feel I'm just being absurd, but I've developed a very powerful feeling that there is an evolutionary force whose aim is to try to move the human race on and to push us up the evolutionary ladder. And that you will see this very clearly in crime. The criminal never seems to succeed for some reason.
They're the ones who are left struggling at the bottom of... They're sliding back down the slope, so to speak. They can't...
Absolutely.
...make it up there.
That's exactly what happens with criminals.
Although you get some criminals who reform...
It's very difficult, actually, to reform very much. But you see, this is one of the central points of my work. When, in about 1962, I received a letter from an American professor of psychology called Abraham Maslow. And what Maslow said was, he, as a psychologist, had got sick of studying sick people because sick people talked about nothing but their sickness. He says, so as a psychologist, he decided to start studying healthy people instead.
Why not?
He'd gone around to various friends and said, who's the healthiest person you know? And he got a list of all these healthy people, and he began to talk to these healthy people instead. Copers, people who really enjoyed, you know, coping, let's say, with the complexities of having a large family and all that kind of thing. Well, he quickly discovered something that nobody had ever discovered before, because nobody had ever studied healthy people. That is, that all his healthy experience that Proust had when he tasted the biscuit dipped in tea. You know, in other words, absurd good news.
Yes.
But he said most people, most really healthy people, get these absurd good news experiences pretty frequently. So, he started studying them, and then he discovered a very, very interesting fact. When he talked to his students about peak experiences, the students began saying, oh, yes, yes, I had the... And then they begin to describe a peak experience. One, for example, was working his way through college by working as a jazz drummer in a jazz band. And he said one morning, at about 2 o'clock in the morning, when he'd been working all evening, he said quite suddenly he drummed absolutely perfectly, couldn't do a thing wrong. And as that happened, he went into the peak experience. And others described similar things. And suddenly, Maslow realized that when his students began describing peak experiences, they were giving one another peak experiences, and they began having peak experiences all the time. When you think and talk about peak experiences, you begin having peak experiences all the time.
It becomes epidemic, or it can do.
Well, in a sense. In fact, we're really back to saints and mystical experiences, because they seem to have this same absolutely inexplicable quality. Now, it seemed to me, I said to Maslow, because we became friends, the real problem, of course, is how you can have a peak experience when you want it.
Your faculty X, really, isn't it?
How you can achieve faculty X.
Yes.
And Maslow said, oh, you can't. He said, the trouble is they come when they want to and they go when they want to, and there's nothing you can do about it. And I said, but the trouble is, you see, what you've just said is a denial of what you're claiming, basically, that all healthy people have peak experiences. And so there must be a way of doing it. And Maslow said, oh, well, if there is, I've never discovered it. But he had discovered it, hadn't he?
Mm.
He discovered that when he got his students to talk about peak experiences, they had peak experiences, he discovered the basic way of the peak experience. In the 1890s, there was a character called Richard Morris Buck, an American, who had spent the whole evening with some friends talking, reading poetry to one another, particularly the poetry of Walt Whitman and Wordsworth, until they were all in a kind of happy, exalted state. Then, when he left them, he got into a carriage to drive home, and suddenly he noticed a red glow in the carriage. He thought, oh dear, there's a fire somewhere, and looked out of the window, and then he realized, no, the red glow wasn't in the carriage, it was inside himself. And he was experiencing this tremendous sense of absolute sheer happiness.
Euphoria.
Well, yes, Proust called them moments bienheureux, moments of intense happiness. And that's what he was experiencing. Now, he then went on to write a big fat book called Cosmic Consciousness, in which he searched through world literature for other people who'd had these experiences of cosmic consciousness, and was the first person actually to write a whole book about methods of cosmic consciousness. But once again, you can see the really significant thing about what I've just said. He had spent the whole evening with friends talking about peak experiences and reading Walt Whitman and Wordsworth. Therefore, he was already in a state to just be pushed over that little rim and into a state of wild happiness. That's what happens every time. In other words, in order to have peak experiences, one thing is absolutely essential. You must be basically an optimistic philosopher or an optimistic person. You see, we are now living in a world that for the past 30 or 40 years has been steeped in a pessimism of culture ever since this bloody idiot Samuel Beckett. In fact, you know, people were doing this before Beckett, but in a way, more forgivably, because T.S. Eliot genuinely was in a state of deep depression and pessimism. Beckett decided that he was going to make literature say life is not worth living, it is utterly meaningless. In other words, he was saying what Shakespeare had said in some of his plays, you know, the player who struts his hour upon the stage and out, out, brief candle and all the rest of it. But Shakespeare was saying that towards the end of his life, when in fact he was feeling pretty miserable and low and depressed. Beckett said it all the time, and what's more, made a very good living from saying it and was given the Nobel Prize for telling us that life is meaningless. Now, this seems to me to be an absolute sign that something has gone very badly wrong with literature and with philosophy. And that, for example, one of the most typical modern philosophies is called postmodernism and declares that there's simply no basic reality, that there's no basic morality, that we are living in free fall, as it were.
What about philosophers such as Nietzsche, who Adolf Hitler read? Was he a pessimist?
Well, no. And it's a pity you mentioned Hitler's name in connection with Nietzsche, because it seems to me that Nietzsche is the only great philosopher ever. All philosophers before Nietzsche tended to agree with Plato that life is pretty miserable. You know, Socrates said that the philosopher spends his life trying to separate his body and his soul, and therefore that drinking hemlock was going to be a way of freeing himself, and so on. And of course Schopenhauer said that all life is pointless and meaningless. And all philosophers have tended to do this down the ages. Nietzsche was the first one who said life is basically good. Now the problem is that unfortunately Nietzsche became identified with anti-Semitism, which he hated. Nietzsche said in a letter to his sister that one of his final acts would, if he was a dictator of the world, would be to condemn all anti-Semites as fools. So, Hitler, in point of fact, would have been one of the first of Nietzsche to condemn. But it does seem to me that Nietzsche is one of the greatest philosophers in the history of the world.
He was
the first person to see that there has to be a positive answer to this question of why we are alive, and that this positive answer depends upon getting yourself into a state of concentration and drive. Now, after years and years of searching for some kind of answer to all this, I had an experience 25 years ago which suddenly showed me the basic answer in exactly the same way that my near suicide at the age of 16 had showed me the basic answer. Now, what happened was this. I had gone on New Year's Eve to a farm in the depths of Devon where there was a kind of meeting of people, and I had to go and lecture. Anyway, when I was there lecturing, it began to snow, and it snowed and snowed and snowed and snowed. And the next morning when we woke up, we were stuck. There was no way of getting out of the farm. To begin with, it was in the bottom of a hollow, and there was about 2 feet of snow all the way back up the road. Anyway, we stayed stuck in this farm for 2 days. And finally, I discovered that my car was one of the few which would actually go up this slope out of the farmyard. And everybody came along, you know, with me with shovels, and we would shovel away like mad, and then I would go on a few more yards. The path to the main road was about a mile away, and it took us all morning to clear the path, and so I could get to the main road. And then finally, I went back and had some lunch, and I jumped into the car and drove off back home. Now, I had to drive very slowly and cautiously, because there were narrow country lanes, and they were deep in snow. And I knew that if I wasn't very careful, I would end in the ditch, because you couldn't see where the ditch was. So as I was driving with this intense concentration, knowing that if I went into the ditch, I'd really be stuck, because I'd just have to walk through the snow and find the nearest telephone and get onto the AA and get them to come and dig me out, I concentrated and concentrated like mad. And when I finally got back to the main road from Exeter down to the depths of Cornwall, this had been churned up by lorries and therefore was free of snow, and I was able to relax for the first time, and I then discovered an interesting thing. I had achieved a degree of intensity of consciousness that I'd never achieved in my life before. And what happened was that everything seemed deeply fascinating. So fascinating that as I drove along the road, I kept wanting to turn my head and look at things. I'd pass, let's say, a house or a tree or a telegraph pole, and it seemed infinitely fascinating. And I realized that I'd pushed myself up into a higher state of consciousness by this 2 hours of intense concentration. Not just intense concentration, but an intense feeling. I might be in deep trouble. And it was this sense of urgency, allied to the concentration, that had got me into this state. In other words, I'd got very close to faculty X. And then, when I realized this, I realized that I'd done quite an interesting thing. I managed to do this on two or three occasions, always with long concentration, and the long concentration would always have the same effect of raising the mind to a sort of glowing level of sheer happiness. In other words, I'd done what Maslow said couldn't be done. I'd learned to achieve the peak experience by sheer concentration. And this has been the most important discovery of my life. To begin with, I found it incredibly difficult to do this, because, when I once had gone to London and had succeeded in achieving this state of concentration on the train, I thought, ha ha, good, I'm going to do it tomorrow on the way back. But it just didn't work. I tired my brain, I'd shot my energies, and there was no way of getting back into the state of concentration.
There were robots everywhere.
Well, yes, but all that had happened, of course, is that I'd used up all my energy.
Yes.
But what I've discovered in recent years is that actually I can do it much more easily. I don't lift myself right into this state, but even driving off to Tesco's on Thursday mornings, I'm able, by concentrating all the way, to get myself into an intenser state of consciousness. It can be done.
Can it be done through conscious, deliberate, regular, disciplined meditation?
Well, I'm not terribly interested in this word meditation, because it tends to involve sinking into a kind of deep state of quiescence, which, while it's important, is not the answer. My states of meditation have always been states of great intensity of will, and this seems to me to be the essential of the whole thing. It's a particular kind of focused will which does it. It seems to me, you see, that we have various states of consciousness. This came to me once when I was in California, sitting in the back of a car being driven back from Los Angeles to San Francisco, and I thought, just for the fun of it, to see how many states of consciousness I could distinguish. And I quickly thought, well, I can quite, to begin with, when you're fast asleep, you could say that that's the first state of consciousness, because you're conscious, all right, but you're also unconscious. And I thought, and then level two is the level when you're just awake, but when you wake up so dopey and tired that really you're capable of doing nothing but just gazing blankly at the room, and it's essentially blank consciousness. Then I thought, level three is what Sartre calls nausea. That is, you're now fully awake, but you know, consciousness is a terrible weight on you. And you find that, you know, you just don't feel like doing anything very much. And then I thought, well, level four is actually our ordinary everyday level of consciousness. This is what we experience all the time when we're awake. But then I noticed that, of course, you can feel sort of terribly heavy and dragged down by a sense of depression. And then if you keep on struggling, you can push the depression to arm's length, and suddenly you begin to get that odd kind of feeling of you can win. And quite suddenly, you begin to feel much better. Now, that feeling of you can win, I reckoned, as it were, was about halfway up level four, you know, say level 4.5.
Hmm.
And if you go on struggling, you can push yourself up to level five, which is, in fact, the peak experience. Now, I realize that what I can do quite easily is push myself up to level 4.6. I can do that without any great difficulty at all. And that is, of course, because I'm basically a person who realizes that it can be done. In other words, I don't waste any consciousness on pessimism and depression. Nietzsche once said, why am I so wise, why am I so clever, and all the rest, and said, the reason is I don't waste time, and a lot of questions that are not worth wasting time on. Now, what he'd done is put his finger on what's essential about getting to a state of consciousness like that of his Zarathustra. You must not waste energy upon depression and, you know, upon really problems that you cause yourself. Now, there is actually a modern psychologist, since Maslow, who realized that, and funny enough, he's called Sid Banks, and he's a perfectly ordinary working man. Now, Sid Banks is American, said that he made his great discovery one day when he was saying to a friend of his, "Oh God, Bill, I'm so depressed." And his friend said, "You're not depressed, Sid, you just think you are." And he said, "What? What did you say?" Because it suddenly hit him that in fact, most of our states of consciousness are due to what we think we are. And that if you can recognize that in point of fact, this is just not true, you see, you think, "Oh dear, I feel depressed," and you almost certainly then begin to feel depressed. But I have discovered that the moment you begin to wake up consciousness and the real you takes over, the real you takes over from the robot, you begin to push yourself up into a state of intensity in which everything actually looks different. Just staring at a scene, you suddenly see it as intensely interesting. And Sid Banks is the first person to really make this discovery. And it seems to me that he is the most important philosopher in the world at the moment.
And in that state, the robot is no longer a controller, it's a helper.
Absolutely.
In its rightful place.
And in fact, you see, you could say that what I've been trying to do it all my life is to turn back this silly tide of pessimism, which has been over modern literature like a great film of grime ever since round about the year 1800. Because 1800 is the year when Romanticism began, and the Romantics spent an enormous amount of time in states of pessimism, and you get this enormously high suicide rate among them, and, you know, deaths from tuberculosis. And that's what I was writing about in The Outsider, the high suicide rate in the 19th century. And is it essential? You know, Van Gogh writes, "Misery will never end," in his last note, and then kills himself. And yet, 6 months before that, he'd painted a painting called The Starry Night, which is a kind of explosion of sheer joy, a super peak experience.
But Van Gogh surely was encumbered by his day-to-day existence. He was in poverty, and he was reliant on his brother to fund him. So the outside world did tend to interfere more with his freedom to be his self, his true self, than would otherwise have been. Would you say that's true?
I would say that absolutely true. And that, of course, is what I say in The Outsider, where Van Gogh is one of the central characters. The central chapter of The Outsider is the fourth chapter, which is called The Attempt to Gain Control, which is about three, quote, outsiders. One of them is Van Gogh. One of them is the dancer Vaslav Nijinsky. And one of them is Nietzsche. But the point, the third one is T.E. Lawrence. Sorry, there's a separate chapter on Nietzsche, Lawrence of Arabia. Now, what I point out is that Lawrence of Arabia had tremendous discipline over the intellect, but not over the emotions or his body. Van Gogh had tremendous discipline over the emotions, but not over the intellect or the body. Nijinsky, the dancer, had great discipline over his body, but not over his emotions or his intellect. So each of those was missing an important part of what would be essential to really achieve duo consciousness and this state of higher intensity. Now, Van Gogh is a third of the kind of person we're talking about. T. Lawrence is another third. Nijinsky is a third third. Bring these three together, I said in The Outsider, and you will have really produced a person capable of faculty X.
A saint, in other words.
Yes. Well, I don't know about a saint, because even the saints, for the most part, didn't actually achieve it. What we're talking about is achieving something more like Nietzsche's Zarathustra in reality, as a real person. You see, I am absolutely convinced that the human race is on the point of an evolutionary leap to a higher stage. that at the moment we have, in a sense, reached a nadir of gloom and pessimism, and we're finding things in terribly, intensely difficult. But it is possible for us to actually get out of this, provided enough people realize that Sid Banks is correct. That our problem tends to be a problem we create ourselves through thought. And as soon as we change the thought, then we've begun to overcome the problem.
We have the freedom to reprogram, really.
That's exactly the right word, reprogram. We can reprogram ourselves and become a completely different kind of person by understanding exactly what mechanisms are involved. Now, I've been doing this, you see, for more than 50 years. And it's only just now, when I'm 75 years old, that I'm beginning to get the hang of it and see the full answer. And of course, my contemporaries, for the most part, don't even understand what I'm trying to do. Oh, no, that's not entirely true. There are quite a number of people who recognize what I'm trying to do. People who started off by reading The Outsider and who've gone on reading my work and have seen the way that little by little I've pushed my way towards this recognition that what we're after is duo consciousness, faculty X. But for the most part, most people don't understand this and probably, you know, won't understand this until I'm dead. Shaw once said, I've solved every major problem of our time, and people still go on propounding them as if they're still unsolved.
They sit in their committees. Actually, it was Shaw who actually wrote, show me your statues of committees in your parks and your cities. Do you remember that
yes.
one? I thought that was wonderful. Colin, I would put it to you about another area of your work in your very long and successful and outstanding literary career. This is the field of alternative history and the occult. Now, I put it to you that that work of yours has come about surely because of your having become gradually convinced of the authenticity of these areas, noting as I do that they are surely somewhat removed from the more traditional psychology which you've explored earlier on. Now, skeptics will have the objection that extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Now, that might come to mind to some when considering these subjects, but would you say that these areas of thought and belief are not always constricted by that type of rigid requirement? Is this why you've been exploring alternative history, as it's called, and the occult?
Well, I didn't plunge into this because I wanted enough proof. I plunged into it because it became to fascinate me incidentally, you know, because it was a part of my total outlook anyway. When I was, let me think, this was 1969, and in 1969 I was approached by an American publisher to ask if I'd write a book about the occult, which was then becoming very fashionable. And at first, you know, I thought, God, who wants to write a bloody book about the occult? What a bore. But then I began to study the subject, expecting that I was going to have to do one of these silly books with my tongue in my cheek, you know, seeing how many untrue things I could convince myself of before breakfast. And in point of fact, the more I studied it, the more I realized that this is just not true at all. That the evidence is overwhelming. An enormous number of people, for example, have had experiences of seeing the future, experience of seeing dead relatives, all kinds of things. And in fact, I suddenly saw that all I was now saying was, so to speak, a different version of what I'd been saying all my life so far, that we have peculiar powers which we do not even begin to understand, and which are simply lying there waiting to be awakened. You see, when I'd been lecturing to the Shaw Society back in 1956, I'd suddenly heard myself saying, man is on the point of an evolutionary leap to a higher phase in which he will have higher powers. And I thought afterwards, you know, was I just saying that? Did I really mean it? The more I thought about it, the more I thought, nope, I did mean it. And I've never ceased to believe it for a moment. And I realized when I began to study the paranormal and wrote this book, The Occult, in which, incidentally, I formulated this concept of faculty X, and I suddenly realized that I've always been pursuing the same aim. And that aim is how human beings can overcome the pessimism of our present-day culture by achieving a certain intensity of consciousness. And I saw that I'd always been thinking about that. You know, G.K. Chesterton, Proust, Maslow, all of these people were leading me in the same direction. And that the so-called occult shouldn't be regarded as some kind of weird abnormality for which we need proof. The occult, in fact, was proved in a certain sense by Proust's experience of the biscuit dipped in tea. But it seemed to me that faculty X, this intensity we're talking about, is also, it becomes more intense whenever we plunge into this peculiar state of, you know, occult consciousness, of a wider, deeper kind of consciousness. You see, in Mallorca, I met Robert Graves. Graves had written a book called The White Goddess, in which he said there are two different types of consciousness, basically. He said one of them is a consciousness which is dominated by the sunlight, our ordinary, everyday, rational consciousness, which has become the consciousness of the West. He said, but there's another kind of consciousness for which the symbol is the moon, the white goddess. And all primitive people know all about that kind of consciousness, and what's more, to a large extent, can control it. You know, there are shamans and so on who can actually plunge into these states by certain disciplines. Now, it was that recognition that we have left behind the consciousness of the white goddess, moonlight consciousness, and plunged into this ordinary everyday consciousness, which is solar consciousness, that made me realize that, in fact, the so-called occult isn't the occult at all. It's simply the other side of ordinary human consciousness. That, therefore, the question is not, oh, how do we prove it in the laboratory? That's stupid. That's saying, how do you prove poetry in the laboratory? Again and again, I've come across cases in which people have suddenly known something beyond all shadow of a doubt. And what's more, they've known it instantly. Now, there have always been human beings who are called calculating prodigies, and they appear to have this same peculiar power. In the 19th century, there was a little boy called Benjamin Blythe, who was a calculating prodigy. And one day, when Benjamin was 5 years old, he was walking at the side of his father, and he said, Daddy, how old exactly am I? And his father brooded on this and said, well, let's see, you're 5 years, 2 months, and 3 days, and 14 hours, you know, if you count today. And the little boy walked along the street, and then about 15 yards further on said, in that case, I've been alive for, I don't know what he then said, 25,300,708 seconds. And his father immediately wrote this down on his cuff. When he got home, he calculated, and he said to Benjamin, unfortunately, you're wrong by 25,000 seconds. And Benjamin said, no, I'm not. You've forgotten the two leap years. Now, that kind of thing is really amazing. You see, when Benjamin grew up, he wasn't an extraordinary genius at all. Very few of these calculating prodigies are. But there is no way of explaining the way that the mind can suddenly leap to this kind of knowledge. It is a possibility always of ordinary human consciousness. We all have it. And if we recognize this, we can actually evolve disciplines that would enable us to do it. And I have always realized this. For example, I've always been fascinated by mathematics for that reason. And in my teens, I used to read a wonderful book called Men of Mathematics by E.T. Bell, because mathematicians fascinated me, and they still do. You know, it was another branch of my interest in science. I have remained, in a certain basic sense, a scientist. All my work has been a kind of science, and all my work has been aimed at the same purpose, to show people that we possess all kinds of powers which we are not fully aware of. My study of the occult has shown me that there's a vast amount of evidence for the so-called paranormal. What's more, I must confess that when I started out studying the paranormal and the occult, I tended not to believe at all in life after death. It seemed to me, oh yes, well, it would be very nice if there was life after death, but it's probably wishful thinking. What we do know is that most of these powers we're speaking of, like the sudden ability to catch a glimpse of the future, do appear to be powers that we really possess. But then, as I went on with this and looked into it more and more and more, I saw that the evidence for life after death is, oddly enough, pretty overwhelming. Now, I'm not a spiritualist. I don't go to spiritualist meetings. I'm not terribly interested in ghosts or any of this kind of thing. But it does seem to me that there is life after death, and that, you know, it's quite important to recognize this as a part of this total picture of the universe.
Well, they've even done a test recently, I think, in a hospital where they put a red shoe on the roof of the hospital and someone went into a coma or died. No, obviously didn't die, sorry. And she recounted, I went up above, outside, and saw this red shoe you'd put on the roof as part of this test. Now, that was out-of-the-body experience.
The out-of-the-body experiences are something that happened again and again and again.
Mm.
And what's more, people can project themselves out of the body. An American friend of mine called Ingo Swan can do this and has done it under scientific conditions. They made Ingo project himself to a place 2 miles away, go into a room, and then describe exactly what is in the room. And he's been able to do it with absolute accuracy.
Yes. Yes.
So we know that out-of-the-body experiences are possible. And another friend of mine, Arthur Ellison, who was a physicist and a member of the Society for Psychical Research, discovered that he could teach himself to project himself out of the body by deliberately concentrating very hard at night and staying awake, and found that he was able to leave his body. Now, this doesn't interest me terribly. I'm just glad to know that this is true, and that it's yet another evidence that we human beings possess all kinds of powers and capacities of which we are not normally aware. Gurdjieff once said, man is like a person who lives in a gigantic house and spends all his time living in the lavatory.
Yes, and of course there are many other rooms that one can feel free to explore.
Yes, absolutely. This is the really essential thing about human beings, that we actually, if we can actually begin to discover that we possess this power, and you can discover it quite easily. I mean, I've discovered it, as I say, by accidents, like that drive through the snow from Sheepwash. You can suddenly discover that we are capable of all kinds of things that we didn't realize.
Yes, yes. Now, can I bring you up to date? You're still working. You're a prolific writer, Colin, and you're still working. What are you working on at the moment? What's your latest book? Tell us about that.
Oh, well, I decided that I would write a book about the so-called angry young men because I'm almost the last one who's left alive.
You're back to the angry young men.
Well, I thought, why not? What happened was that 3 years ago, some man approached me, a man called Humphrey Carpenter, and said he was writing a book on the angry young men and could he come and see me? And I said, yes, okay. He seemed a terribly nice, friendly chap. He came along, stayed here overnight. We gave him a sort of magnificent food and wine. I gave him some of my 1930 bone. And
really?
And he seemed very nice. And then, about a month later, suddenly, a great fat typescript arrived, and with his piece about coming to see me as an introduction. I realized the only reason he'd been to see me was that he wanted a good introduction to his book.
Mm.
And I sort of, you know, shrugged. Then my wife looked for it and she said, hey, have you read the chapter about you? And I said, no, because I can't be bothered really to read about myself. I already know about myself. And she said, well, read it. And I read it, and it was an absolutely filthy attack.
Oh, dear, oh dear. This is the criticism coming to hand. So how long have you been at this book so far?
Well, I've been at it over 2 years now.
Yeah.
You see, it's terribly hard work because, for example, I have to deal with all of the people who are classified as angry young men, which includes novelists like Kingsley Amis, John Wayne. Yeah. Even Iris Murdoch was classified as an angry young man.
Iris Murdoch?
Doris Lessing is another one.
Uh-huh.
There was a book called Declaration, which came out. It was supposed to be the credos of the angry young men,
yes,
which included myself and John Osborne, but also included Doris Lessing. So she was automatically included. And so, what I've had to do is to settle down and read a vast amount of stuff that I've never read before. You know, in other words, the works of the other angry young men. And that's one reason that it's taken me so long.
Well, we'll be looking forward to this. When do you expect to complete this, or are you unsure yet?
Well, I started the last chapter yesterday.
Right. So we're
so fairly soon, I hope.
It'll be out when, before Christmas?
Oh, yeah, within a month, I hope.
Okay, that's, we're now in August 2006. Colin, you have a website. Could you give us the web address?
The name of it is Colin Wilson World.
ColinWilsonWorld.org?
I guess that's probably it. If you put in Colin Wilson World, you probably get it.
We'll find it. Now, your books are all freely available worldwide in all good bookstores. Many have been reprinted, haven't they? I think there was The Philosopher's Stone.
There are about 20 or 30 of my books available, you know, from Amazon.
And how many languages do you think your books have been translated into?
Something like 30.
30 languages. It's incredible. It's incredible.
The Outsider, incidentally, has never been out of print.
I gather so.
From the moment it was published.
There's nothing to compare to it. There really isn't.
Well, I don't know. As I say, I've always experienced a tremendous amount of hostility, which began at the time of The Outsider.
Yes.
My second book was absolutely slaughtered by the critics, a book called Religion and the Rebel. And I think this was mainly because I'd been far too successful with my first book. And everybody was sick of the bloody angry young men.
Well, the saying, religion is man-made, God is not. Would you hold that's true?
Well, on the whole, I've always been sort of rather dubious about what Bergson called closed religion.
Yeah.
Bergson said there are two kinds of religion: open religion, which is the religion of the saints and the mystics, and closed religion, which is the kind of religion that people go to church to worship, you know, the religion of thou shalt not and all that kind of thing.
In the halls of dogma.
I've always felt that strongly.
Yeah.
But that second book of mine is simply a part of the kind of things that I've been writing all my life. What I'm trying to create is a kind of philosophy which is based upon optimism rather than the kind of pessimism which has been around ever since Plato and Aristotle. You know, Aristotle said, it is better not to have been born, and death is better than life. So, I'm trying to create a different kind of philosophy. And the only person who really wanted to do that, apart from myself, was Nietzsche. And, of course, unfortunately, the strain was too much for him, and he went insane. But here am I still, you know, at the age of 75, and still going strong. Bernard Shaw said that human beings will live, eventually, to be 300 years old. And I can suddenly see exactly what Shaw meant. Once you really begin to understand what it's all about and how you can do it, you can actually begin to swim towards it, so to speak. It is terribly like swimming in a certain sense. You're moving through a kind of medium that is rather like water.
Yes.
Shaw, in Back to Methuselah, makes one of the characters say, when someone asks him, well, you know, how will this come about? He says, oh, it will just happen. That's where Shaw was wrong. It doesn't just happen. You have to discipline yourself to a very large extent and understand what you're doing. You see, I feel that those attacks on my second book, Religion and the Rebel, were actually one of the best things that ever happened to me, for the simple reason that suddenly I felt I was back on the good, solid ground again. As it was, I'd been in this vertiginous world of fame, which really, you know, got me nowhere. It wasted an enormous amount of time. What I've done ever since that happened with the second book is work on quietly and steadily on my own. I live in the midst of the countryside, and, you know, I've always been a happy family man. Joy and I have got three children and sort of a dozen grandchildren.
It's rich, isn't it? Rich and accomplished. This is what you must feel. No, I don't mean rich in a material sense at all, or monetary sense.
Well, we've always been fairly broke. We've always had an overdraft. But, you know, this has never really worried me because I've always had so many different ideas for books. That's the reason I've written so much. I've always been so bloody broke.
I think your wealth exists in other realms. It really does, Colin. you know.
I suppose so.
Colin,
we were very lucky to buy this house when we did.
How many years?
In 1959, because 1959. It cost a mere £5,000 back in those days. And of course, it's now worth about 10 times that.
Yes.
I mean, 100 times that.
And of course, where you live, we don't need to know exactly where you live, but it's in a beautiful part of the West Country in the UK,
yeah,
where it's quiet, it's natural, it's not been spoilt by too much urbanisation, has it?
Well, I live in a part of South Cornwall.
Right.
The nearest little town is Mevagissey,
yeah,
which incidentally is the town where Shaw wrote The Doctor's Dilemma.
Oh, right.
And I've been here now, as I say, for since 1957. You see, this is a bit much to mention at the end of a program like this, but
mm-hmm.
What happened was that in 1950, early 1957, yeah, Joy's parents turned
yep.
up at the house, Joy's father carrying a horsewhip. He said, "Wilson, the game is up. We've discovered your filthy life, and that actually you're a homosexual and you have six mistresses." And it turned out finally that what had happened is that when I'd gone to visit Joy when she was in hospital with
yep.
A grumbling appendix, her sister had opened my diaries, which I'd left in my rucksack on the dining room table, and had got a completely weird idea about me because they were full of notes for my novel about Jack the Ripper, Ritual in the Dark. And so anyway, finally, I managed to get rid of them. They tried to drag Joy away, literally, and all of the tenants of the house came in and pulled her in the opposite direction. I sent for the police and we finally got rid of them. But unfortunately, we hit the headlines of all the front pages the next morning. This was another cause of my notoriety. And Golang, my publisher, said, "For God's sake, get out of London or you will never write another book." And that's the reason that when the man in the next room said, "Oh, well, I've got a cottage in Cornwall, which you can have for 30 bob a week," I said, "Okay, done." And we moved down to Cornwall in 57, and we've been here ever since.
Yes.
And it was the wisest move we've ever made.
And, of course, it's a beautiful mystic landscape you live in, with a lot of standing stones, circles. Have you explored around?
Oh, absolutely, yes. Yes, it's full of fascinating stone circles and that kind of thing. We live on a hilltop, looking out over sort of 50 miles of horizon. And, you know, we've been terribly lucky finding a place like this.
Yes, I bet you have. I bet you have. And a perfect setting for you to continue with your work. Colin, we're going to wrap up very soon on this. It's been a wonderful...
I think we better.
Wonderful.
You said you wanted to do an hour and you've done two already.
Conversation, well, almost. We'd like to thank you very, very much for your time here at Astro Magazine and Web Radio. I'm Guy Lee, your host. Our listeners are going to find this marvellous to listen to. And on behalf of everyone here, we wish you all the very best for the future and your current work and its success, and our warm thanks to you.
Oh, it's a great pleasure, Guy.
Colin Wilson.